everyone. My name is Rob Coleman. Today I'll be doing a presentation for the Raleigh Outdoor Photography Club on street portraits. I told back to travel. So, like many of you, I got into photography doing landscapes because they're easy, relatively speaking. They don't move, no complain. And one of my other interests, like many of you, is travel. And so I started out trying to go to all these exotic locations and take landscapes, which is hard for a number of reasons, not the least of which is to get up early, to look at the right lights, or you have to catch a train to your next location. You're always there in the middle of the day. And then often what ends up catching your eye is not the actual landscape, but the people in the landscape. So as I've kind of progressed as a photographer, I've started to take more photos of people, which is really, really hard, especially if you don't know them, even more especially if you don't speak their language. Unlike Bob, I do not know a lot about portrait photography, so this is going to kind of be just some of my experiences that I've picked up on just over the past few years traveling and attempting to take people's photos in the street around taverns, and hopefully something that will be useful to you as well. So the biggest conundrum that you run into when you're trying to take photos of people in the street is, of course, how you get a candid shot. Or how do you get a natural shot? Maybe it's candid, maybe it's not. And a lot of times that comes down to the question of, do you try to sneak the photo or do you ask them to take the photo? And everyone has their own comfort level with that. Sometimes you can't. You have to ask them because there's no way around it. Other times you can sneak a shot, and some people feel that's impolite. And I'm not going to get into more of an ethical argument about that. But I will outline a couple techniques that I found helpful, both in terms of engaging with your subject as well as avoiding engaging with your subject. And hopefully. So, sometimes there's no way around it, you have to engage with your subject. But this is often not as difficult as you might think. I am not a particularly outgoing person, so this was a big hurdle for me initially. Just working up the nerve to go and talk to a random stranger and ask them if I could get their photo. This particular gentleman was standing outside of his blacksmith shop in Buenos Aires, wearing that expression you see on the left, and I was pretty sure there was no way he was ever going to let me take it. But there was no one on the street. He was standing right in the doorway. There's absolutely no way I could snuck a photo of him, and he just looked so... I don't even know how to describe it, but he had this look about him standing there in the doorway. And I really wanted to take a photo. And first I just shook my head and I walked past. No, I just can't. And finally I was like, well, okay, I might as well ask, what's the worst thing? So I go up and I ask him, and he said yes, in Spanish. And at that point I learned just enough Spanish to learn how to ask, may I take your photo? And nothing else. So he attempted to engage me in conversation, and his English was very poor. That did not go very well. But the surprising thing was he looked like he wore that scowl 24 hours a day, and 30 seconds later he was smiling. Which brings me to the point, most people enjoy having their photo taken, either because they find it flattering or for any number of reasons, or because they're simply too polite to tell you no. There are some exceptions to that, but in general, you'll find that you have more to worry about the photo simply not being good than not being a great photo. And people will surprise you. You may think that asking someone if you can take their photo is going to ruin the moment, that it's going to break them out of whatever it was that caught your attention in the first place, and that's often the case. But sometimes it's not. And sometimes they'll start doing something else that's equally as interesting. There's also ways that you can politely ask to take their photo without engaging with them on quite such a close-up level that may encourage them to stay involved in the behavior that caught your interest. One technique that I've found to be helpful if I am a fair distance from the subject is to just raise my camera and smile. It's universally obvious to pretty much anyone that you're saying, "Hi, may I take your photo?" But without speaking to them and without being close up, they're less likely to try and stop and pose and break out of the behavior that you've got. People are often more likely to let you take photos of their kids than of themselves. This surprised me initially, because here in the U.S., there's always a concern of the creepy guy with the camera taking photos of kids. In my experience overseas, this is not usually the case. I went to Morocco in May, and in Morocco they have a cultural and or religious aversion to photography. Many people told me no when I asked if I could take their photo. But surprisingly, if I asked if I could take photos of their kids, they were beaming smiles every time. And as a bonus, children tend to be a little bit less self-conscious around the camera. They'll open up more, they'll play. They haven't grown to learn yet about bad camera angles.
Did you find some kids asking for bakshish?
I'll touch on that. yes, I did. And parents enjoy seeing photos of their children as well. So you take photos of their kids and show them the photos and offer them the photos. They're often very grateful. So let's talk about some techniques to not engage with your son, because you want to direct them to more natural behavior. One strategy that I found helpful was to pick a location and camp out. And shoot the location less than the people in it. If you're walking through a place where you are clearly not a native, which if you're a pasty Scot-Irish guy in a 7th century market in the Middle East or North Africa, you're going to stand out. There's no way to live in. So what I found to be helpful was to pick a spot that I found interesting, and rather than trying to shoot people moving through that location. People were less likely to believe that I was taking their photo, even if they didn't think the primary subject. And once you stayed there a while, people became less likely to notice your behavior as being the tourist who's just blowing through and taking 500 photos. This does somewhat require being on your own or in a very small group. If you're in a very large group, it's ruined. So in this case, I found some interesting rays of light that were passing through the smoke coming out of the grill, and I probably stood there for 30 or 45 minutes just shooting people moving through smoke. There's also the vaunted paparazzi technique. Use telephoto lens. This was a shot in France where I was at the end of this alleyway, and I was in one of those touristy squares in Nice, and I looked down this alley, and there were these kids playing soccer in the alley. And I happened to have a 300mm lens, so I just didn't bubble in, took the shot. This doesn't always work. Oftentimes, especially in more crowded locations, a telephoto lens just won't. It'll just be too much in the way. But sometimes. the hip. This is really, really hard. I ran into a lot of situations where even before I could ask, people would see your camera. And in many of these locations, especially if it's a heavily touristed location, they know what a DSLR looks like. It has a certain intimidation factor to it. If they even see it, they'll be wagging their finger at you and saying, no photo. So there, one technique that I did try a couple times was leaving my camera by my side, pointing it in the hopefully the right direction, and just taking a shot without ever raising it to my eye. The vast majority of photos I took using my camera were completely throwaway. But occasionally I got some that were salvageable. Both of these were shot in the way. The one on the left is probably the only shot that I shot from the hip that was actually completely sharpened and focused. That was a lady that was sewing this metal bangles outside of the mosque, I believe. But then other times you might get an abstract shot that you actually like for completely different reasons. Sort of right. And that is how it came out as far as focus and angle I don't know, process. But it takes a lot of practice and a lot of manipulation. You can also shoot their pets. This man had these dogs. He was just relaxing. This was in the Jewish quarter. Very interesting. Pain of love. He was just kind of relaxing with his pets. And I asked if I could shoot the pets. And he said, yes. Misdirection is often a really fantastic way to get photos of people, is if you just tell them you're shooting something else. So let's talk about paying for photos. A lot of people will either ask you up front, if you're in a heavily touristed area, for money before you can take a photo, or after you take a photo. And on a ethical level, this seems like a great thing to do. I mean, what's a couple dollars to you for a great photo? My experience has been is that if someone asks you for payment before you take the photo, you're not going to like the photo. They're more likely to stop what they're doing and pose, and they're not going to look natural. And in many cases, this is because they deal with this day in and day out. So you have to have some sympathy there, where you have crowds of tourists flowing through that just do nothing but snap photos all day and don't buy anything and then leave. But generally speaking, if you see something interesting and you have to engage with the subject and they ask for money, you're probably better off moving on and buying another location. The exception to that is if you can engage with them beforehand, especially by purchasing one of their goods, engaging them in conversation. That can often get them to open up, maybe show you parts of their workshop, and you're more likely to get more interesting things out. This is especially true in many countries that have more traditional marketplaces, where the vendors will take a lot of pride in their products and their workshops, and many times if you show an interest, they'll be happy to take you into the back where they keep a lot of other products. And you can see the loom the rugs are made on, and all these interesting photo opportunities. And oftentimes, it just takes a little bit of conversation or purchasing a small trinket to kind of get them to see you as something other than the average tourist. And that's all I have. Thanks for putting this together. I appreciate it.